with diluted DPS. Diluted DPS, so what we did was basic. Diluted DPS is that the number of shares which you will calculate, it will include not only the existing shares, it will include the existing shares plus the potential shares. Potential share means those shares which you have not issued yet, but you have made a promise to be issued in future. For example, shares under IFRS 2, share-based payments, convertible bonds, etc. So the basic EPS is calculated by comparing the profits with the weighted average number of shares currently in issue. However, it is possible that an entity might have a commitment to issue shares in the future, for example, share options or the conversion of convertible debt. So if you consider these commitments are known by IAS 33 as potential ordinary shares, and they may result in a change to the basic EPS because your number of shares will increase. So those shares which you have to issue in the future, you are also adding them today. You are assuming as if they were issued in the current date. And that is called the diluted EPS. So diluted EPS is based on existing plus future or plus potential ordinary shares. The diluted EPS therefore warns, now that's important, it warns the current shareholders of what may happen to the EPS in the future. Because current shareholders, they see EPS is, you know, $10, oh, that's very good, they are happy. But then they do not know that there are some commitments as well, and there will be some new shares as well. So we are just making an adjustment and telling them that if we include the calculation of these future shares, EPS might go down to $8. So just be aware of this situation. The most efficient way to calculate the diluted EPS is to take the earnings figure used in the basic EPS calculation and determine how it would change if the potential ordinary shares become shares. Earnings will also change. Earnings, how they will change? Let's suppose that you have a convertible debt, which consists of there's a $1 million worth of convertible debt at 6%. Okay. And you say that upon conversion, I will issue, let's suppose you will convert it to 50,000 shares. Okay. So your basic EPS here, you calculated like you had profit of, let's suppose you had profit of 400,000 and you had number of shares 200,000 and your EPS was $2. So once you make this conversion, your number of shares will become 250,000 because you say that it will be converted to 50,000 new shares. So number of shares will increase. Your earnings will also change because before you were paying on 1 million, 6% interest, which was 60,000. So as soon as your convertible debt is converted to shares, you stop paying this interest because before you had debt in your hand and I was paying you 6% interest. The moment I take back these bonds and I give you shares, I stop paying my interest. So my profit, my earnings will go back to 460,000. So the change will be on both sides. The change is not only that there is an increase in the number of shares, there will also be a change in the earnings. And that would result as when you stop paying interest. So based on this, you need to calculate your diluted EPS. Now, if I divide it 460 by 250, So these three zeros are gone. This is gone. This is gone. 46 by 25, maybe it is $1.8, let's suppose. It would be something like this. So this is what it says, that take the earnings figure used in the basic EPS calculation and determine how it would change. How it would change means I will add up the interest if the potential ordinary shares become shares. If these shares, potential shares become shares, what will happen? Take the weighted average number of shares used in the basic EPS calculation and increase it for the number of potential ordinary shares. Like, so first you change your earnings. First you change your earnings, which I said 460,000. Then you change your number of shares, which will become, let's suppose, 250,000, and then you divide them. So convertible debt, adjustment to basic earnings and number of shares where an entity has convertible debt. So let's suppose earnings, basic earnings, add back loan interest, like 400 plus 60,000, 460,000 it will become. Number of shares, this was my basic weighted average number of shares, 200,000 before. This is additional shares on conversion, let's suppose 60,000. I add them and this is my new number of shares. We do one question here. Aecon company had the same 10 million ordinary shares in issue on both 1st April 2001 and 31st March 2002, which means that we did not issue new shares. On 1st April 2001, the company issued $1.2 million one units of 5% convertible loan stock. Each unit of stock is convertible into four ordinary shares, which means 1.2 million. If I'm giving bonds, so 4.8 million will be the new shares, because $1.2 million one in dollar one unit, which means 1.2 million bonds I'm issuing. And for every bond, we have promised four ordinary shares. So upon conversion, you will have 4.8 million new shares. And the following is an extract from Aecon Company's statements. You had profit before interest and taxes, 980. Interest payable on 5% convertible loan stock, 60. Because 1.2 million into 5%. Makes it 60,000. Profit before tax 920, income tax at 30%, and profit for the year 644. Let me tell you, I'm sorry, I forgot to mention, when I said that I had 400 my earnings before, and then I said that I will save my interest 60, so I said my earnings will be 460. Now, this is possible, but this does not include the tax impact, because actually in reality, when you will stop paying 60,000 interest, so this is additional income for you, increase in income for you, and you must pay tax on that. So if the tax rate is 30%, so actually I should not be saying 460, my change in earning would be 400 plus 70% of 60, which is 42. So my new earnings should be 442 after tax, if we include the tax impact. Like, it would be very naive to say that I had 400 in earnings before, and if I stop paying interest, the 60,000 will come to me. 60 will not come to you, because 30% you will have to pay the tax, and which makes it 18,000. What you will get in net is 42. So the change in earnings would be 442. Just like we said, we got 60 here. So it is 980. You pay interest 920. Then you pay tax. It is 644. If I have to remove this thing, I would say 644 plus 60 into 0.7. So this is my new number of shares, 644 plus 42, it should be 686. New earnings would be 686 if we stop or remove this thing. Do you understand this tax issue? Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay, makes sense, right?
Yeah.
आपके. सो कैलकुलेट द बेसिक एंड डाइल्यूटेड अर्निंग्स पर शेयर फॉर द ईयर एंडेड 31st March 2002. सो बेसिक वी विल टेक आवर अर्निंग्स व्हिच इज 644 एंड वी वुड डिवाइड इट विद दे हैव करंटली 10 मिलियन शेयर्स. सो 644 डिवाइडेड बाय 10 मिलियन व्हाट एवर यू विल डू. सो 644 डिवाइडेड बाय 10 मिलियन 6.4 सेंट्स इज माय करंट बेसिक ईपीएस. For diluted earnings, what we need to do, so the same thing, like if you see that 644 basic plus 1.2 million into 5%, which is 60,000, into 7%, 42. So 686 would be your earnings, post-tax earnings, because we take here PAT, profit after tax, okay? We calculate with profit after tax. And then number of shares, 10 million were there. And you said that for 1.2 million bonds, every bond, I will give four shares, 4.8. So 14.8, 686 divided by 14.8, your diluted EPS becomes 4.64 cents. Now, if you see that, what was your basic EPS? I think basic EPS was 6 point something. Yeah, 6.4. Here it shows 6.4. So now that's a big difference in EPS, you see. Basic is 6.4 and diluted is 4.64. Share options or warrants we have. Again, it's the same thing, like one was convertible debt. We just considered convertible debt, that this debt will be converted into a certain number of ordinary shares. But you might have IFRS 2 share options. You have given to your staff some share options, which will be exercised. When an entity has issued share options or warrants, individuals will have the right to buy shares at a certain point in the future. The price they will be required to pay will almost certainly be below the current market price. Because if it is not current market price, why would they buy shares? Or why would we offer them? So it has to be below the market price. If it is below the market price, then there is a discount element. Remember, we said that market price was $5. You were issuing the right issue at $4. So we said because we are not issuing at full market value, this is full market value. But it is discounted. So it has a discount factor of $1 because you are giving a discount. The same happens in share options. Share options, they will always be certainly below the current market price, and therefore there will be some discount factor inside of that. This amounts to a situation where some of the shares can be deemed to have been issued at full price, and the remainder will effectively have been issued for no consideration. Now, what does that mean? Let's suppose that if I am issuing 100,000 shares and market price was 5, I am giving at 4. So it means that I'm giving that M at 80%, right? So I'm offering these shares at 80% of the value. If the market price is 5 and I say that I'm giving you share options to buy shares at $4. So actually I'm giving you 20% discount, or you can say that you are paying me 80%. So how we treat that? We consider that 80,000, because 100,000 into 80% means 80,000. So it looks like that 80,000 shares have been issued at full market value and 20,000 shares have been issued as bonus for free. So just to make things easy, this is another way of seeing it. Instead of saying that in all 100,000 shares, there is some discount. One way of seeing it is that 80,000 into full value, like, because when they will pay, when you tell them that you pay 100,000 shares at $4, so what they are going to pay, they're going to pay you 400K. So if I consider 80,000 shares at full market value, which is 5, that is also 400K. So instead of treating this thing like this, we consider 80,000 at full market value and the remaining 20,000 as a bonus fraction. Are we clear on this thing?
Yes, sir.
Great. It is only the shares deemed to have been issued for no consideration which are dilutive. So those shares which I'm giving for free, they are dilutive. Dilution happens because people are not paying cash and they are getting shares. If you are selling them at full market value, there is no dilution. Dilution will not happen. Dilution of earnings will not happen. What is dilution of earning? Dilution of earning means, now that's a very important concept, please. Conceptually, you should understand. If there is a share which is for market price 5, and I am selling it to you for 5, I had my X dollar in profit, and I had my Y number of shares. So after issuing these shares, my profit X, and plus, because I receive $5, so I will receive $5 into certain percentage, which I will reinvest the money. And at the bottom, it will be Y plus 1. So this one share is bringing its benefit into the company at the existing rate, $5. No problem at all. There is no dilution of earnings. Diluted EPS, diluted earning per share. Dilution means to become weak. Dilution means to become weak. When you dilute some liquid, for example, in milk, if you put water, so what are you doing? You are diluting the milk. In schools, we remember that we did some in chemistry labs, some experiments, diluted acids, diluted chemicals. To dilute something means to make something weak. In this case, I don't see any weakness because one new share is added and that share we received the full cash. And that cash would be invested and it will bring its return. So there is no problem. The problem happens when you have X dollar, previously profit, and Y number of shares, and then you add Y plus 1, but the shares are issued on bonus. You don't receive any cash. So no cash means no additional profits. Your profits remain same, but only this becomes Y plus 1. This is a situation where earnings will become weak, where earnings will become diluted. This is the concept. Now, dilution will happen. One, we understand that dilution happens in case of bonus shares. Because in bonus shares, we are not getting any cash to reinvest and earn more money. Our earnings will not change. Earnings will remain same. Only the number of shares will increase and EPS will go down. So on bonus shares, there certainly is a full dilution. I consider it as a full dilution. But in case of right issue, there is also some dilution. Because in right issue, what happened? That share price was 5, but I issued it at 4. So then what will happen? That you will have X over Y and Y plus 1. And this will be 4 multiplied by a certain percentage. So if I consider now this thing, because I issued it on bonus, right issue, so if it had been a full market value, it would have been $5 into the expected rate of return. Here it is $4 into expected rate of return. So actually $1 I received less, and naturally speaking, $1 I invested less. So my additional or incremental profits will be less as compared to this case. If it is full market value, no dilution. I'm fine. If it is bonus share, there is dilution, full dilution. But if it is right issue, there is still some partial dilution. Now, these terms are not given in the book. I'm just creating myself. Partial dilution, which means that I did receive the cash, which I will invest and I will increase my earnings. But unfortunately, the cash is not the full amount. Cash is slightly less than my expectation slightly less than the market price. So my earnings will be there, but they will not be as good as they would have been with $5. So some dilution is happening. So now to summarize, when you have full market value, there is no dilution. When you have bonus issue, you have dilution. When you have right issue, there will be some dilution, or you can call it partial dilution. I just devised this term. So like it says now, it is only the shares deemed to have been issued for no consideration which are dilutive in nature. So in this example, which I was saying that if you had 100,000 shares and instead of selling them for $5, you are selling them for $4, which means at 80% value, you can consider that you are selling 80,000 shares at full market value, and you are selling 20,000 shares as bonus for free. So these 80,000 shares will not cause any dilution. Dilution will come only because of these shares. Are we clear on this? Huh?
Yes.
Great.
Yes, clear.
Allah. So these are added on the basic weighted average number of shares. And if you remember that, when you had that thing impact of, we will add in into weighted average number. We calculated this thing in previous question, how to calculate the weighted average number. So let's see some example. Share options, warrants, performa calculation, number of shares under option, number that would have been issued at average market price, AMP, number of options into exercise price divided by AMP. What is average market price? I will explain that $5 and $4 difference, whatever. And number of shares treated as issued for nil consideration. So what are the number of shares under option? You had number of shares under option were 100,000. What are the shares which you are issuing at some consideration, which are 80,000? Remember, 80%. And for nil consideration are 20,000. This is which is going to create dilution. Now let's see some example to understand them better. Question to consider. Galaxy company has a profit for the year, 3 million for the year. 1.4 million ordinary shares were in issue during the year. Galaxy also had outstanding 250,000 options for the whole year with an exercise price of $15. So currently 1.4 million are there, 250,000 options, each option share price is 15. The average market price of one ordinary share during the period was 20. So you see that market price is 20, full market value, and the option price is 15. So there is some bonus component into that thing. You can consider that bonus component as $5, or you can consider it as 25%. So it's that 25% of dilution we are going to expect. So calculate the basic and diluted EPS. Basic EPS would be straight away. Future shares will not be considered. Earnings are 3 million. Ordinary shares are 1.4 million. And they are throughout the year because it says that they remain there issue during the year. So I don't need to calculate different parts. Okay. I don't need to calculate how many shares are for which period of the year. Throughout you have 1.4 million. So life becomes easy. Otherwise you have to calculate weighted average. So for this thing, I don't need weighted average. So let's calculate here. 3 million divided by 1.4 million shares. Your basic EPS is 2.14. That is correct. Now, for diluted EPS, what will happen? Number of shares under option 250,000 and number that would have been issued at average market price. Remember 80% concept, which I was giving you before. In this particular case, you are actually making it 15 by 20, which means that 75%. So actually 250,000 shares, I would consider 75% here and 25% here. Can you multiply 250 into 75%? Do we get the same thing? 250,000 into 75%.
Yes.
So 187,500, these are the shares which now you can consider that these are the shares actually at full market value. And these are the shares which you are giving for free. These are the shares which you are giving for free. Because when you said that a $20 share I'm giving at 15, it means I'm giving 25% discount. So it means that they are actually paying only 75%. So they are going to get 250,000 shares in total, but they are going to pay 75% of the value. So 75% is this remaining value. These are the number of shares which they are going to get as for free. So then I said diluted EPS will be 3 million. So these shares, I don't have any problem. Okay. This share, they are going to get at, they will pay me $15 for each share. I will calculate this amount. This amount might be 5 million. I will invest this 5 million in my business and earn money. No problem with this. Problem is only with this thing. So I said that 3 million plus 1.4 million plus 62,500, this is diluted EPS. Now, I just very quickly jumped on to the conclusion because I want you to ask me or answer me this question. Why did our earnings not increase? We did not make any change in the earnings. Why did we not make any change in the earnings? It was 3 million before, I'm considering 3 million now. Although we are issuing shares, we are getting this much of cash, okay? 187,500 into $15. This is the cash, which is something like 1.8 million, 1.87 million, 900,000. Approximately 2.8 million cash we are receiving, okay? So this cash will definitely be invested in the business and your earnings would increase. We are not showing the impact of that thing. Why? We are saying earnings are still 3 million.
This is a potential shares, right?
Yeah, but if they would be converted, you would have received 2.8 million and you would have invested it and your earnings would have increased. We are saying earnings will remain same because we remove the impact from here and here as well. You see 1.4 million, we are not adding 187 here also. We are not adding it here. So we assume that these shares, which are issued at full market value, they don't create any dilution impact. In reality, what would have happened? In reality, because they did not tell us what is this company's rate of return. How much at what percentage do they invest money? If they tell me that, by this money would be invested at, let's suppose 12%, then how would I have done that? I would have said 3 million. The correct answer would have been like this. Plus this 2.8 million, which I will get now into 12%, because I'm already earning 3 million. I will invest 2.8 million further. I will receive cash. I will invest it at 12%. And then I would say divided by 1.4 million plus the total number of shares, like 187,500 plus 62,500. So this is actually the real life scenario would be like this. 3 million, your current earning, plus the cash which you receive and invest, and then the number of shares, total, if you make a total of these things, it is 252,000. But for the sake of simplicity, and also we do not know what is the rate of return, we assume that full market value shares are not causing me any problem. So I just ignore this part from here, and I ignore this part, corresponding number of shares. So these number of shares and their expected return, I remove the return from the top, and I remove the number of shares from the bottom, just to make it simple. So I say 3 million, 1.4, only this part will remain because this is not adding something on the top. Are you clear?
Yes, sir. Because the dilution talks about the bonus.
Yeah, so the bonus, dilution bonus is from the bonus. Free. Yes. So I'm just including the bonus shares here.
Yeah. Yes.
Because the other shares, like in reality, you would have received the cash and you would have increased your earnings. So in diluted EPS, you say earnings. I ask you, will your earnings will remain 3 million? Answer is no, your earnings will increase. So why do you not show the increase? Yeah, because there was an increase on the shares as well. I just canceled out these two things. Impact is not necessary. This impact is not needed to be shown. So what is going to impact you? I mean, I'm just explaining you, this is the calculation side of this, and this is the conceptual side of this. Are we clear?
Yeah, very clear.
Okay, great. So you just take your previous earning and you find out how much is the bonus component within that. How much is the bonus component within this total M number? And you just increase the number of shares and you get your diluted EPS. This makes life rather easy. Presentation, disclosure, and other matters. So the basic and diluted EPS should be presented on the face of the statement of profit or loss and other comprehensive income for each class of ordinary share. The basic and diluted EPS should be presented with equal prominence, so that you don't say, you know, your basic EPS, you write down like this, you know, $10, and somewhere in the bottom, you just write down diluted EPS, $7. So, you know, it looks like that you are cheating the shareholders. Equal prominence, so that shareholders should know that this is what is current situation, and this is what it would have been with the potential shares. And disclosures should still be made even if one or both of the EPS figures are negative, indicating a loss for the period. So even if you are making a loss, earnings are, there are no net earnings, there are net losses. So you, of course, you will get negative EPS. So that should also be shown. Significance of EPS. EPS is frequently used to compare company performance. It's one of the most important measures by investors. A lot of investors are not very, finance gurus. They are not probably qualified financial experts. They are simple investors. So they can't go dig deep into the financial statements. They see few signs, and one of those signs is EPS. The EPS calculation is also used in price earning ratio, which is often used for investment decisions. It is very important because we calculate, this is a formula which is called PE ratio, price earning ratio. It is also used, this price earning ratio, which price earning ratio means market price of the share divided by its EPS. And that is called, you know, you call it PE ratio, price earning ratio. It is used also to calculate the market price of the share as well. Sometimes they tell you what is P, what is price earning ratio, by the way. I'm not going into very deep detail here, but just to give you a quick view, let's suppose that there is a share which has a market price of $30. And this share has, an EPS of $3. So it means that if you purchase this share at $30 today, and then what do you expect? You expect $3 earnings, not dividends, earnings. So it means that whatever investment you will make today, it will take you 10 years to earn it back. It will take you 10 years to earn it back. So it means that whatever I'm investing now, $30, after investing 30, I'm earning 3. So I need 10 years to recover my money. Of course, not in cash because it's not in dividends, but to recover back my investment in form of earnings. So this P ratio is actually a very, commonly used comparative ratio for different companies. There is a company A, there is a company B, there is a company C. This company share price is 30. it is giving an EPS of 3 and it has a PE ratio of 10. There is another company which has a share price of 21. They also have an EPS of 3 and they are giving at 7. So if you invest in company B, you would invest $21 and start earning 3, 3, 3, 3, 3, and in 7 years, you can roll back your investment, not in cash, but in earnings. There's a company C, which has share price of 36. It is also giving EPS of 3 and they are giving back in 12 years. So what do you understand from this data? You understand from this data that it tells me now what? Now, which company should we be investing money? Now, if I ask you, should you buy this share or should you buy this share or A or B or C? Rajesh, what would be your choice?
B.
B, because it can bring back money faster, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
I actually would not buy B because I would say that it is giving $3 EPS. Why its share price is not increasing in the market? Why people are not willing to buy the share? Because if there is a demand, the share price should go up. You know what it looks like? That people have very high expectations about company C, and market wisdom, the collective wisdom of the market, it never fails. The collective wisdom of the market is everybody wants to invest in C, and that's why they are even willing to pay $36 just to get $3 of earning. So, I mean, nobody is coming here. Everybody is going and putting money in this company. Do you understand? There's another side of the story. You think that it is low, it is good. I think that why if it is low, it is bad. Why everybody is coming in and willing to pay 36? Because this company might have some future potential. So higher PE ratios, they show you, you know, better expectations for future, because there might be a company D and that company D has a share price of 20, which is giving a dividend of 4 and PE ratio is 5. This company, which means that this share is not demanded in the market. To earn $4, people are not willing to pay more than 20 in this business. To earn $4, people are not willing to pay more than 20 in case of D. That's, you need to see. So ideally speaking, what happens that this is the best choice in the middle, not on the right, this lower side. This is a big question mark. This is a big question mark. Why share price is low? Why investors are not attracted here? This one, I would see a kind of risky thing, because I know that sometimes there is a hype in the market and prices are artificially inflated. So if I buy it at 36, I'm afraid that in some period of time, it might go down to 30, 32 or 33. So I feel that there is a risk that it is overpriced. It is overstated. Safest deal is always in the middle. Do you understand? Okay. Now, it means that PE ratio is important. Now, what PE ratio has got to do with our EPS thing? So in EPS and PE ratio, the relationship is that sometimes they will tell you that a company which has a PE ratio of 8 and EPS of $3. So there are 1 million shares in issue. So how much would be the value of this business? Now, there are very different ways of business valuation, very complex ways. I'm just giving you a very rough idea in a very rough way, that a company which has a P ratio of 8 and they have an EPS of 3 and there are total 1 million shares are in issue. So what is the value of this company? What is the value of this business? how would I do? I would say that PE ratio is equal to market price divided by EPS. PE ratio is 8. Market price of the share, I do not know. EPS is 3. So it means that market price of each share is $24. And there are 1 million shares. So this business value is 24 million. This is the relationship between EPS and PE ratio and business valuation, because PE ratios are available in the market for each industry. So if I am into an in different market, I mean, different countries, each industry. For example, you are in Kuwait, and in Kuwait, we say furniture industry, furniture showrooms. What is the average PE ratio in this furniture industry in Kuwait? It is $10. It is 10 times 10. Oh, 10. Now, what is EPS? EPS is of one particular company. This 10, I will take it from the industry. And EPS, because there is a company, there is a furniture showroom, which is Alpha, which is being sold. And I want to invest money or I want to buy it. How would I give it value? I would say that Alpha does what? Alpha is in furniture business. Where? In Kuwait. What is the furniture industry PE ratios in Kuwait? 10, 11, 9, 10. I will take 10. What EPS they are giving? They are giving EPS as 4. So it means that the share price is 40. How many shares do they have? 1 million. 1 million times 40, 40 million is the value of the business. So this is like we say that significance of EPS, that EPS calculation is also used in PE ratio, which is used for investment decisions. Are we clear on this thing? I mean, this calculation, there is no confusion, I hope.
That's clear, sir.
Okay, great. It should, however, be noted that EPS is based on historical, not prospective data, and so in an indication is an indication of past rather than future performance. Yeah, of course. Because EPS, what happens? EPS is based on this data, okay? Until 31st of December. You are sitting somewhere here. And during this period, many things can change. So the EPS, which I'm seeing here, this actually belongs to this period. And 6 months have passed. During 6 months, we started two projects, which one of them is not really going very well. We had one product which had failed. There was a new competitor coming into the market. There was some change in the technology in the last 6 months. There is some political change in my environment. There are three key management, top senior management personnel who have changed, who have left us, and they have gone to another company. So it means that when I'm sitting here and I am actually depending on my EPS, which is based on 31st of December, it is quite possible that decisions might be wrong. So you have to be very careful. So don't think that if you have EPS, you can value a business or you can make an investment decision, because you are taking investment decision in July, in June, in August. Data is from 6 months in past, and in business, in 6 months, many things can happen. Political governments can change. Things can change. New technologies, they come in. New regulations, they come in. New legislation, they come in. New competitors, they come in. Your staff members, they go out. Your products start failing. Many things happen. So that's why we say that it reflects to the past rather than the future performance. The IAS 33 calculation of EPS includes one-off income expense items which distort the EPS figure, because it happens that every year, when you make your income statement, within your income statement, sometimes you do have some extraordinary items. We call them extraordinary items. Those items which do not happen every year. You have some Olympics season in your country this year. Because of that Olympic season, you got some bigger contracts and your income statement and your profits, they suddenly went up. But Olympics do not happen every time, and you do not get the contract every time. So therefore, sometime you have one-off income and similarly expenses, which will distort your otherwise thing. So this is actually the end of this chapter, EPS. Important and interesting topic.